documentary off, we're going to touch on a couple of Nils Krogstad's character traits, the first being his deceitful nature.
This deceitfulness is witnessed throughout the play through his acts of forgery, blackmail, and the continuous lies that he has to deal out to his family and to all those around him in order to keep his acts a secret.
To show this, we're going to show you a couple lines from the play itself right now. But tell me, was it really such a crime that Krogstad committed?
Forgery? Do you have any idea what that means?
Couldn't he have done it out of need?
Yes. Or thoughtlessness, like so many others have. I'm not so heartless that I condemn a man out of wrongdoing for just one mistake.
No, of course not, Torvald.
Plenty of men have redeemed themselves by openly confessing their crimes and taking their punishment.
Punishment?
But now, Krogstad didn't go that way. He got himself out by sharp practices, and that's the real cause of his moral breakdown.
Do you really think
Just imagine a man with that sort of guilt in him, to lie and cheat and deceive on all sides, has to wear a mask, even with the nearest and dearest he has, even with his own wife and children, and with the children, Nora. That's where it's most horrible.
In that scene you just saw, Nora and Torvald Helmer were discussing Krogstad's deceitful past and why his reputation has been so ruined.
In this next scene, we are going to show you Krogstad's villainous side of him, which is the second of his major character traits.
I need to talk to you.
What is it?
It's for you.
He mustn't ever get that letter. Tear it up. I'll find some way to get money.
I don't want any money from your husband.
What do you want then?
I'll tell you what I want. I want to recoup, Mrs. Helmer. I want to get on in the world. And there's where your husband can help me. I want to go back in the bank, but in a better position. Your husband can set up a job for me.
He'll never do that.
Oh, he'll do it. I know him. He won't dare breathe a word of protest. And once I'm in there together with him, you'll just wait and see. Inside of the year, I'll be the manager's right-hand man. It'll be Nils Krogstad, not Torvald Helmer, who runs the bank.
Welcome back to E! News. I'm Julie Beffler, and Marina Mazurek is sadly sick today, but I have my co-host, Samantha Salem, here.
Hello.
Okay, introduce our next character trait.
Okay, so you just saw the side of Krogstad that was villainous and deceitful. So these villainous ways they may seem cold-hearted and corrupt, but they were only brought by his desperation and his desperate attempt to pull himself ahead, and which you will see in the next scene.
This horror, it's going to happen. No, no, no. It can't happen. It mustn't. Talk quietly. My husband's home.
Well, good for him.
What do you want, then?
Some information.
Hurry up, then. What is it?
You know, of course, that I got my notice.
I couldn't prevent it, Mr. Krogstad. I fought for you to the bitter end, but nothing worked.
Does your husband's love for you run so thin? He knows everything I can expose to you. And all the same, he dares you to.
How can you imagine he knows anything about this?
No. I can't imagine it either now. It's not at all like my fine Torvald Helmer to have so much guts.
Mr. Krogstad, I demand respect for my husband.
Why, of course. All due respect. But since the lady's keeping it so carefully hidden, may I presume to ask if you're also a bit better informed than yesterday about what you've actually done?
More than you could ever teach me.
Yes, I am such an awful lawyer.
What is it you want from me?
Just a glimpse of how you are, Mrs. Helmer. I've been thinking about you all day long. A cashier, a night court scribbler, well, a A type like me also has a little of what they call a heart now.
3, 2.
In that last scene, you saw Krogstad threatening Nora to expose their little secret to her husband. And in those lines, you really see Krogstad's desperation, for he's desperate after he receives the notice that he's going to be fired from his position at the bank.
Although this makes him seem like an evil man, we're now going to touch on a softer side of him, his compassion.
I need to have someone to care for, and your children need a mother. And we both need each other. Nils, I have faith that you're good at heart. I'll risk everything together with you.
Thank you. Thank you. Now I know I can move back to place in our eyes. Yes, but I forgot.
Shh! The tarantula! Go on! Go now!
Why? What is it?
Hear that dance up there?
Mm-hmm.
When that's over, they'll be coming down.
Oh, then I'll go. But it's all pointless, of course. You don't know the move I made against the Helmers.
Yes, Nils, I know.
And all the same, you have the courage to...
I know how far despair can drive a man like you.
If only I could take it all back.
You easily could. Your letter's lying in the mailbox.
Are you sure of that?
Positive, but...
Is that the meaning of it, then? You'll have your friend at any price? Tell me straight out. Is that it?
Mills, anyone who sold herself for somebody else once isn't going to do it again.
I'll demand my letter back.
You just saw Krogstad's compassionate side when he was talking with Christine and offered to take his letter back.
Now we're going to show you his self-destructive fault.
Krogstad's self-destructive fault was his insecurity. His insecurities led him to deceitful ways, such as when he forged the banknotes and blackmailed Nora. It was only when Christine left him for a richer man that he felt he wasn't good enough and felt that self-fulfillment could be filled by seeking more money. So he forged his signature on banknotes to gain wealth and to gain stature in society. But when he was caught and his reputation was ruined, he feared that he was going to lose his job at the bank. So that's when he started to blackmail Nora to try to convince her to convince her husband to let him keep his job at the bank. So his insecurity was what was driving his deceitful ways and leading him to believe that he wasn't good enough just the way that he was, and his self-approval was ultimately being driven by his internal struggles.
Hi, welcome back to the E! True Hollywood Story on Nils Krogstad. So right now we're going to be talking about the relationships between the different characters in the play. Should I go first?
Oh, yeah.
So I have the relationship between Mrs. Lynn and Krogstad. So originally, Christine and Krogstad, Christine Lind and Nils Krogstad, they were in an intimate relationship, but then she left him for a wealthier man.
Oh my gosh.
Tragic.
I mean, she did it for herself and to take care of her brothers, but still, I mean,
that is just
what a gold digger. And then, just like Krogstad's a horse notes for money, because he was insecure of himself and didn't feel good enough,
so he just started
committing crimes. Inevitably, they meet up again with the Helmers. Christine was going to take his position in the bank because she just needed a job. And then they reconnect later on in the play on an intimate level when they're talking about the note that Krogstad had placed in their mailbox. And I have some
lines.
Thank you. All right, so Mrs. Lim says, "Nils, if only we two shipwrecked people could reach across to each other." Right? And then Krogstad says, "What are you saying?" And then Mrs. Lim says, "Two on one wreck are at least better off than each on his own."
It's true.
Right?
Oh, deep.
So this is the first moment that Krogstad has a full change of heart. But then when Christine agrees to be the mother of his children.
That's a big one.
Yeah, Krogstad says, "I can't believe it. I've never been so happy."
Aww.
And that's just a full transition.
Wow.
So this relationship can be defined as being complicated, but then changes to like intimate and close relationship.
Mm. Oh, nice.
So, yeah. So who's next?
Okay, I'll
talk about the relationship between Nora and Krogstad.
Nice.
So they have an interesting history, a long one. Early in Nora and Torvald's marriage, Torvald was like getting really ill, and Nora thought the only solution was to take him to Italy, so she needed the money to do it, and so she went to Krogstad to get a loan.
Oh.
And when she did that, like, her husband was vulnerable, and she really wanted to help him, so she ended up doing it illegally and forged her father's signature after he passed away. So there wasn't anything else she could do. She just needed the money, and so she went to him. Mm-hmm. And so eventually, later on in the play, we figure all this out, and it ends up that Krogstad is going to lose his job at the bank because Torvald just doesn't want him at the bank anymore. And so he starts to manipulate Nora to talk to her husband Torvald and to convince him that he should be able to stay at the bank. And he brings up this history that they have where she illegally borrowed money and uses it against her and starts to blackmail her. So in a way, his relationship with her is really business-like, and she's really scared of him and afraid that he's going to reveal all this past that is going to ruin her relationship with her husband.
Yeah, that would ruin it.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, he ends, like you said, he writes that letter to Helmer, explaining everything about what happened with the loan and the illegal forging, and he wants to give it to Torvald, and so Nora's just screwed.
It's true, I mean, she is.
Gosh,
that really sucks.
Yeah. Wow. Dr. Rank? Oh, Dr. Rank is next, maybe?
Yeah, okay.
He's the only one that didn't know Krogstad on a personal level.
Yeah, they never really, like, talked, did they?
Yeah, no, never one-on-one, but he just judged him from his past and his position in society, which was obviously not good after that scandal broke out. And so Dr. Rank even said, oh, it's a lawyer, Krogstad, a type you wouldn't know. His character is rotten to the root. So he really sees Krogstad as a morally invalid person, but yet he has never really met him, and so this relationship is very impersonal.
Makes sense. I mean, it happens often.
Yeah, they don't really know each other.
That's, he just doesn't like it?
Yep.
Hard time.
Just a
hater. Haters don't hate.
Okay, so should we move on to
Helmer.
Torvald Helmer?
Oh,
yeah. Him and Krogstad, they actually used to be really good friends, like, when they were...
Childhood friends?
Yeah.
Oh.
When they were teenagers, they, like, were really good friends, and however now, they're more just acquaintances, and Krogstad actually thinks they're better friends than they really are, because he just feels comfortable calling Helmer by his first name and just acts like they're still best friends. However, Torvald now references their friendship as one of those rash friendships that crop up again and again to embarrass you later in life. So he's really embarrassed, like, by his association and how Krogstad makes it seem like they're just best friends. So they're not, like, connected like they used to be. He's just more annoyed, so they're just acquaintances now.
Mm-hmm.
Friendship stayed.
They do. Yeah. All right. Well, that wraps it up for this segment of the show, and we'll see you in a little bit.
Hello, I'm Samantha Sandlin, and I'm going to be talking to you guys a little bit about the dramatic change that Krogstad experienced throughout the play. In the beginning, he was a very self-centered man who his only focus was pulling himself ahead and earning money for himself. But as the play progressed and he began reconnecting with Miss Lind, he became fulfilled, and he went from a self-centered, like, empty man to a fulfilled, loving, compassionate man. And so at first, like I said, he was only worried about himself and taking care of himself, and we see this through his many deceitful actions, such as forging the signatures on the banknotes to get money for himself to become rich after Mrs. Lynde had left him for a rich man. And that his blackmailing Nora was only to secure himself in his position and even move up in the ranks at the bank. So as you can see, he was very self-centered and concerned only with his own life, and he didn't care who else he hurt as long as he was pulling himself ahead. But once he began reconnecting with Miss Lynde, Krogstad was finally able to stop searching for complacency in his life through these superficial means such as the money and the titles, because he had finally gained back what he had lost and loved so long ago. So he was really in love with Mrs. Lynde, and he never really stopped loving her. And so when they decided that they could be together once again, this caused him to want to end his deceitful ways and right his wrongs, and he went from being such a self-absorbed man to a loving, compassionate person who was willing to move forward and wanted to correct.
Krogstad's failing quality came about through his forgery of bank statements. He was insecure with himself, and this led him to be dishonest in his life. He committed both forgery and fraud of bank statements. It did not stop here, but he also acted out and started to attempt to blackmail Nora. This all started when Miss Lynde had left him for a wealthy man, and his stature in society was gone. If he had never turned to these means of becoming fulfilled, he would have been able to avoid his failing quality. But sadly, that was not the case.
Come on. Oh, wow. Hi, guys. I'm Michael Bayham, and I'm going to be explaining the one aspect of humanity, empathy, that Niels Krogstad portrays in the play. So, with my handy-dandy iPhone, and according to dictionarytoday.com, empathy is the experience of understanding another person's condition from their perspective. So with that definition, I'll give you a little bit of background. In the beginning of the play, Niels is portrayed as being dark and deceptive, as he intends to blackmail Nora for not returning the amount of money he had lent her. But towards the end of the play, Niels becomes empathetic and wants to retrieve the note he had put in the Helmer's mailbox, letting Torvald know what Nora had done, forging letters. So, as you guys know, Nora forged her father's signature to receive money in order to save Torvald's life. And then Krogstad forged signatures and notes, mostly for himself, but also for his children. So, both Nora and Krogstad committed fraud, not just for themselves, but mostly for their loved ones. And this similarity allows Krogstad to understand where Nora is coming from and why she actually did it. So although Krogstad wants to retrieve the letter, Mrs. Lynde, who later becomes his lover, tells him not to because Torvald needs to understand and figure out what Nora had done. So this transition from being a dark and deceptive character to one of empathy and understanding portrays the one aspect of humanity that Krogstad expresses and highlights in the play.